welcome to episode 61 of Pros. This week, find the wonder in death magic. And enjoy the exciting penultimate section of Jack Lee's Ants of Fire, The Legend of Teela. Just so everyone knows, I am still pondering whether to stick with this long form or not. So as I have mentioned before now, feel free to chat with me through social media or by emailing the show directly at prospodcast@gmail.com. Also, let me remind you all that if you've not yet followed the show on social media, please do so on any and all platforms under the name at prospodcast. The best way to truly help the show, though, is by leaving a rating or review on Apple Podcasts, aka iTunes, or on any podcast service. Ratings and reviews are what help others find this show. For easiest access, subscribe using whichever podcast catcher is your favorite. Thanks for listening. Let's get to the tale, shall we? This week we have Ash and Bone and Jack Lee's Ants of Fire, The Legend of Teela, Parts 31 and 32, Return and the Hunter. Enjoy. Ash and Bone, an original short story by Jared I. McGee. Well, that is certainly unexpected. I can't believe it worked!
Shh! Someone will hear you!
Mina shushed Jensen, swiveling her head to take in the dim surroundings in the small clearing amid the heartwood.
Someone has already overheard, child. Not that that matters. Anyone within a mile could see that dancing light on a moonless night like this one. Extinguish it, son.
Small flame was hopping up and down excitedly in the boy's hand. Jensen took his other hand in a quick motion and snuffed the fire between his two palms.
Father, I know what you and the mayor and the council say about the magics, but this was just a little bit of fun for Mina's birthday. It's tomorrow, and I just thought...
Jensen's father, Orin Finholt, an intimidating man to even his closest, most beloved friends and family, drew himself up to his full height and sent a weighty look down at Jensen.
Son, would you like to see what your little birthday present / experiment cost?
Orin reached into his oil sack he kept at his left hip and pulled out a small rabbit. It was gasping for air, its chest rattling like something was coming loose in a body that was clearly racked with pain. Patches of its fur seemed to have been ripped away, as if a dog had gotten a hold of it and had been playing roughly with it without fully going in for the kill. Its eyes were wild, the sclera mottled with blood spots. Its eyes were sad. Its eyes were accusatory.
Son, would you like to hold this creature whose life you took tonight? Would you like to feel the breath leave its body?
The rabbit didn't struggle as Orin offered it to Jensen. It lay still, labored breathing still teetering in and out of it, a nasty wheezing sound accompanying most breaths along with the rattle. As Jensen moved a little closer to see the rabbit, knowing that his father would beckon him to do so if he did not do so on his own, the rabbit did begin to move weakly, pushing itself as best it could away from Jensen, there in Orin's massive hand. Fear radiated from the little beast.
Do you see, son? Do you see how it fears you? Do you see the cost of your actions? Will you give it mercy?
Jensen knew what that meant. Showing an injured animal mercy was nothing new to him, but his father putting this pitiful creature before him and telling him it was his doing, the torture of the small creature. That stayed Jensen's hand. He stood quietly and unmoving.
I can't, Father. I just can't.
Mina had stayed back and observed this exchange. Though she'd grown out of her habit of crying at the slightest provocation, her eyes welled up and threatened to overflow now.
By no means were Mina's tears or her propensity for crying a mark of childishness or an inability to act in the wider, harsh world. Her crying was more out of her acute, empathetic qualities rather than any inherent weakness. And here, with this careening, gasping rabbit begging for someone to save it or at least help it escape its misery, she was barely holding them back. Still, even as her heart was breaking, she knew that the rabbit couldn't be made to live on. Mina stepped forward, putting an elbow out to nudge past Jensen and toward his father. With Jensen's soft whimpering and sniffing behind her, she reached out, took the creature from Oren, and broke the little rabbit's neck with one swift crack, much as she did with her grandmother when it was time to harvest the chickens. Then, she did let her tears fall openly, shutting her eyes so hard it hurt. Then her face felt heat and light, and she opened her eyes to see Jensen's hands alight again, crackling and sizzling with white-hot flame. She took steps away from him and closer to Oren.
"Now do you see, my children? You both know full well what the priests teach. In this dead gray world of ours, the only way to make magic work is through death. Through ash and decay and bone and blood and death. Death and death alone can bring those ancient energies back into this world. So this little amusement you two thought up for yourselves? It was fun, right? The flames on Jensen's hands are beautiful, right? See well with what cost that beauty comes."
Oren gestured with the now limp body of the rabbit.
"A small flame maimed the beast, torturing it in ways that neither of you can imagine. With death came a stronger call to those forces, and so Jensen's hands burn with the white-hot fires of the realm of the adversary herself. Iron in the blood, bacteria in the rot, marrow in the bone. Who knows where the true power lays? The learned ones of our times debate it hotly. But we all know, you both know damn well, that nothing good comes when we bring this power into our reality. Jensen, son, put out your hands and let's walk back to the village. I wish we could cube this rabbit for stew, but we do not need to eat the defilement that you brought into it by taking from its life. We'll have to burn the beast so other animals cannot get it and become defiled themselves."
Jensen followed suit, dousing his hands in a small puddle at the base of the tree. But as he and Mina went to follow along in his father's wake, he couldn't help but recognize his excitement that was tinging his terror. All the stories were true. The mumbo-jumbo and fairy tales that the wise ones and crones and others spoke of to the children was all true. Jensen also did not fail to recognize the sidelong glances Mina was stealing at him. She looked angry? Jealous? Afraid? Maybe something else altogether. Jensen was never good at reading girls, especially Mina. Despite the warnings and the morbid display he just witnessed, Jensen thought of his father's saying the rabbit had to be burned and its ashes scattered. Ashes meant more release of life, cracking of bones and burning of marrow. Ashes meant another chance to touch that electricity just on the other side of his own skin, of their own reality. Jensen got goosebumps as they made their way farther out of the woods and closer to their village. He'd get some more practice tonight, and this time he could do so without any killing. The three walked on, breaching the tree line and heading into the village through the mazework of fields. Oren ground his teeth and kept his worried gaze stone. Mina let her eyes dart all across the ground, trying to look at anything but Jensen, lest he see how little she thought of him and his cowardice she'd seen out in the forest. Jensen smiled tightly, trying to conceal his joy at what he just learned and barely being able to contain his desire to whistle as they tramped back toward home. All three having been changed that evening. Thank you for listening to Ash and Bone. This story is something special to me, and you might just be hearing some more stories set in this world in the very near future. The musical track in the background of the story is from freemusicarchive.org. It is being used under a CC0 1.0 Universal Public Domain Dedication license. Stick around for the penultimate installment of Jack Lee's novel, Ants of Fire, The Legend of Tilo. After a very long journey with Tilo and the other ants, we are almost at the end of our months-long quest. Ants of Fire, The Legend of Tilo, a novel by Jack Lee. Parts 31 and 32, Return and the Hunter. Part 31, Return. Tilo and the Queen flew across the massive room where their family had worked and slaved for the roaches. They saw piles of bodies scattered all over the floor from the attack. The Queen flew downward to take a closer look at her dead children. Tilo saw a familiar ant among the corpses.
That's the attendant that led me here. She helped me organize the workers during the battle. Should we stop for her?
Those things will be out after they finish with the drone. And we can't get them all. I can't stop for one without wanting to take them all. I would at least like them placed to rest outside in the sun and the soil where they belong. Not in the dark world of roaches and abominations.
Tilo peered closer at her dead friend's body. She noticed that she had her pincers through the head of a black ant and her stinger buried inside the side of another. The attendant had tried to fight after all.
Maybe after our new colony is established, we can come back for them.
The roaches will have long eaten them by then.
Do you think the roaches will follow us outside?
Right now, I don't care. It has been so long since I've felt nature's wind through my wings.
Tilo and the Queen flew across the room until they reached the windowsill. They landed on the edge and took a look back through the abandoned building. The Queen turned to the world outside and felt the sun on her face.
Tilo, I think I'd like to walk the rest of the way. It has been so long since I felt the soil under my feet and the sun on my wings. We can always take to the air if we run into trouble, but for now, I want to enjoy this.
Tilo and her mother descended down the wall and reached the sidewalk. After a few steps, they were once again in the grassy jungle where Tilo had grown up. Tilo had never felt so glad to see the warm greens of the world, the clear blue above her, and the bright yellow sun in the sky. Tilo and the Queen followed the scent Tilo left on her journey to the building. They passed the spider web where Tilo had found the attendant. The spider's corpse still lay in the clearing where Tilo left it, lost to any scavengers or predators that would have enjoyed the easy meal. Tilo and the Queen fed on the spider's dead flesh. It had been aged in the air and the sun.
Oh, this is the best thing I think I've ever eaten, the Queen said. What did you eat while you were held captive, Mom?
Things that queens shouldn't eat, she said, a hint of sadness in her voice.
The Queen hung her head and finished chewing her bite of spider.
Like what?
My eggs. Pieces of my daughters that had died working for those things. Ants never feed on fallen members of their own colony.
What do we do with our dead? You'll see. I'll teach you everything you need to know about being part of a colony. A real working family. Everyone has their job and their place. Even soldiers?
The Queen looked at Tilo and smiled. Especially soldiers.
Tilo felt her heart swell. She felt the contentment and excitement that can only come with being with one's own family. The fear of not belonging evaporated. She imagined herself helping the Queen take care of the new young being formed in the Queen's body. She wondered how she would be able to instruct new nurses on the care of babies, of teaching guardians to protect the colony, of teaching hunters and gatherers the art of finding food to sustain the colony. Teela would have to learn and instruct her new sisters in every part of the colony, just like her nurse did. The queen finished her eating, and the pair continued their walk to the hole Teela shared with her nurse. Teela told her mother everything. She told her about the nurse, about the cricket, about how her nurse died, the other colony, finding the attendant in the spider's web, everything. And all the while, the queen listened to Teela with her full attention and nodded with a gentle smile. The two aunts approached the area where Tilo's nurse had died.
Her body should be here. I left it here.
Neflotia, the stone?
No. There is where my nurse and I were attacked by those flies. She should still be here. There should be a piece of her body or something.
A hungry creature probably stumbled upon her remains, Teela. That is the way of things.
Can I look around a bit for a body? I'm sure I can find something.
Teela, there is nothing to find. Let's go to our new home. My eggs are stirring.
Teela looked downward in defeat. She thought that her queen should at least be able to look upon her one daughter that fulfilled her purpose. While the other members of the six gave up or were caught or became traitors, Tilo's nurse did the best she could with what she was given and did her part to make sure the colony survived. The nurse was the real hero, not Teela.
I know I can find a trace of her. I just need to pick up her scent again.
There is no scent but yours here, Teela.
She's gone. Come on, let's go. Teela dragged her feet and the ants continued their way to the hole in the ground. When they finally reached the hole, the queen took a moment to look around and take in the landscape.
I know that once I go underground, I'll start raising antlings and I won't be able to come up for some time. Maybe never again.
Does that make you sad?
Not at all, it is my place. But I do want to have this memory before I go in.
The memory of this new beginning of standing here with you.
It smells good, doesn't it?
The scent of memory?
Yes, Teela smiled. Of history.
Teela looked at her mother. The queen was so beautiful, so warm. Nothing like her nurse. But Teela finally understood why the nurse had been so cold. It was the nurse's place to raise and train. It was a mother's place to love.
This place in the earth will be a great place for us to start, the queen said as she crawled into the hole in the ground. My new young will be here soon. It will be a great undertaking to feed us all. But I know you are more than capable of taking care of that.
Thank you, Mother.
You're welcome, Teela.
Please be in the habit of calling me Queen or Your Majesty before your sisters get here.
I will, Queen. Would it be improper of me to ask your name first, though?
Of course not. I'm Mara.
That's a beautiful name.
My mother gave my name to me just like I gave your name to your egg. I need to hurry inside. I feel my egg stirring inside me.
I cannot wait to see my sisters. I'll start hunting for some food for us to store.
Don't get too excited about seeing your sisters, soldier,
a familiar voice said. Teela turned around.
I'll be the last sister you ever see, and I'm the only hunter here.
Part 32. The Hunter. Teela looked across the clearing and saw the hunter ant she had thought she had buried in the drone's chambers. Her shell looked cracked and scarred from being buried. She was missing one of her antennae, and her abdomen and stinger were covered in the blood of roaches.
How? Teela said.
I climbed my way out. I fought through several of our benefactors.
I didn't think I would find you, but I found your scent.
Foolish of you to walk out here where I could track you. Follow you close behind.
Those antlings will never be born. Your colony ends here. The hunter charged across the clearing. The queen climbed inside the hole in the ground to safety. Teela sprinted toward her opponent. They clashed in the middle of the clearing, their legs tangled together and their pincers clawing at each other's armor. They locked stingers and wrestled each other to the ground. Teela felt her legs begin to loosen from her body. The hunter stabbed her remaining feeler into Tilo's wound on her head where the spider had broken the armor that protected her face so long ago. Teela screamed in pain and unwrapped her legs from the hunter. She freed her front legs, but not the ones under her abdomen. She shoved with all her might and pushed the ant with so much force that Tilo's rear legs were ripped from her body. Tilo's body fell to the ground. She pulled herself around the soil, trying to steady herself, but without her rear legs, her stinger kept dragging along the ground. The soldier flung Tilo's rear legs to the side. She leapt onto Tilo's back and held her to the ground. She dragged her pincers through the wound on Tilo's head and thrashed Tilo's back with her abdomen, forcing Tilo's body onto the soft soil.
"I'm not going to sting you. I'm going to break you against the ground."
Tilo struggled to move. She looked at the hole in the ground and wondered what the hunter would do to the queen if she didn't stop her. She tried to force her body upwards but couldn't. The hunter was just too strong. Tilo's eyes darted around the clearing, looking for anything that would give her the upper hand. There was nothing. She resolved herself to being beaten to death, but then Tilo's eyes caught a hint of movement. The grass was moving and swaying, as if a gentle breeze had begun to sweep across the terrain. She listened closely. She heard a light buzzing overhead. Tilo recognized it as a beating of wings. Not large wings like those of a butterfly, but small wings buzzing like a grasshopper on a long flight. The grass around them shook and moved, enraptured in a breeze that was growing more and more heavy and violent. "Do you hear that?" Tilo said. The breeze began howling.
"What is that?"
High above their heads, three forward flies were approaching. The three flies spoke as one.
"The large one will make a good home for our babies."
The hunter looked upward and saw the three flies buzzing in the air.
What are they doing?"
The buzzing stopped. The first fly buried its stinger into the back of the hunter's head. Tilo felt the pressure ease off of her back. She began reaching for the ground in front of her, pulling herself towards her home. She felt the hunter roll off of her back. The second fly pierced the hunter in the same wound. The third finished the attack. Tilo crawled into the hole and dropped to the ground. She heard the forward flies buzzing fade in the distance. She heard the sound of the hunter screaming. It would not be long before the fly's young had already begun to feed on her brain.
"Tilo? Queen?"
Tilo struggled to breathe. She felt the cold air of the cave seep through her shell and penetrate her flesh underneath.
I think I'm broken, Your Majesty."
The queen examined Tilo's shell. It was cracked and gashed and cut. Tilo's life fluid seeped from her body and began to sink into the soil.
"You are not broken, Tilo."
Tilo felt the life begin to leave her body.
I don't think I'm going to be able to build a colony with you, Mother." "Perhaps not, Tilo, but I'll be all right. I'll never get to know my family."
The queen embraced Tilo with her legs and wrapped her wings around her daughter's battered body. She touched her head to Tilo's and lay her feelers against Tilo's. Tilo felt a rush of images flood her mind. She saw the birth of young ants, the digging and building of a new colony by workers, the gathering of food and the death of prey. She saw tunnels in the queen's chamber. She saw ants bringing the young to the surface during the rain and the sight of drones flying in the air to breed with new queens. She felt everything every ant had ever felt, the joy of new creations, the ways of ants being passed on to a new generation, and the defense of the colony against its enemies.
"Are you dreaming, Tilo?"
I'm home.
"Yes, Tilo, you're home."
"I'm with my family."
"Yes, dear child, you are right here with us, with all of us."
"My nurse had dreams. She dreamt of our sisters. How she missed them. How they were slaves."
"We're not slaves anymore, Tilo. You saved us. You fulfilled your purpose."
Ease and comfort coursed through Tilo's body. The sights and smells of the cave grew fainter. Her eyes darkened. The last bit of air that her lungs would ever produce poured out of her body. Tilo succumbed to her wounds then, closed her eyes, and stopped fighting. Thank you for listening to Ants of Fire, The Legend of Tilo by Jack Lee, parts 31 and 32, Return and The Hunter. The musical tracks in the background of the story are from both Free Music Archive and freesound.org. They're all being used under CC0 1.0 Universal Public Domain Dedication licenses. This does it this week for prose. I truly hope that you'll join us in 2 weeks' time for the very, very last installment in this epic novel by Jack Lee. What a ride we've had with Tilo, huh? And before I leave, I do have to tell you to continue to love those around you. Tell them that you do, and embrace this life as it is always stranger than fiction. Thank you for listening.